Oh, thank you, Tony. Listen to this, folks. Blue sky, cloudless sky. Unbelievable. So the conditions here at Snetterton have been fantastic. We've already had one of these Eastern Airways sidecar races, won by Sean Hegarty and Callum Lawson, just flashing through the picture there. But Tim Reeves and his brother Tristan James came from the back of the grid to get second, smashing the lap record all the way.
Yeah, that's right. And that means they still lead the championship. Yeah, I mean, there's nothing like when you get sort of put to the back of the grid, whatever reason you have a problem, coming through the full pack and getting some quick laps in. I really used to enjoy that when I was racing, and Reezy seemed to relish it yesterday.
Well, the lap record here is set by Ben and Tom Burchell, who are away at the Southern 100 next week, 156.1. He did a 155.837, and there you have it. That gap now down to 20 points. Hegarty trails Reeves by Andy Peach. Ben Holland did not score, so he is only 4 points ahead of the outfit in fifth place. Mark Edwards, Lee Barrett, Roger Lovelock and Aki Alto, finished passenger, in for the rest of the season. They're reigning champions in sixth. Barry James, Mark Howard, Ian Drown, Ken Edwards, Craig Chapo, Johnny Briggs alongside him. Steinhausen and Clues not here. The German doing something else this weekend, probably at the seaside, who knows. Horsepole Napton, Stevens Charwood have blown an engine, so they won't start. Roger Boddy is there on 36. Ian Guy had a cracking first race, but he too has had problems. It is absolutely fantastic here. Track temperature around 40 degrees. Hegarty there on pole, you can see, but Reeves, that's your front row. Peach and Lovelock line up row two alongside them. Then it's Mark Edwards, Lee Barrett on the extremely rapid Kawasaki. Barry James, Mark Howard. Number 57, Tony Brown, a wild card from the BMCRC, the BEMCI. So his fifth ever ride on an F1 sidecar outfit, finished seventh in the first race. Phenomenal. It's a 10-lapper. It's going to be warm, as they say.
And it is. And do you know what? One of the things about these sidecars, you're actually, the driver's tucked in completely the whole time. It's not like they sit up at the end of the straight and get the vented leathers, get some air through. These lads get really hot, and they're actually cuddling, their arms round and their legs round a red hot engine anyway. These things are like little cookers.
And about 300 degrees coming off the front brake.
Yep, that's it. Yeah, all underneath that fairing.
All underneath that. You're absolutely spot on, yeah. Okay, the red flag moves away. Green flag at the back of the grid. We're going to get lights here. The first bend of riches, of course. This is taken in about fifth gear. As they go off the line, the lights change. And Tim Reeves is riding like a man possessed this season, the reigning world champion. But where is Reeves? He's behind Hegarty. Hegarty's got the drop. Sean Hegarty leads Tim Reeves into riches for the first time.
I'm not sure he's going to take him long to get past Hegarty. He's going to try around the outside into... And that's, he's gone straight around the outside into Montreal Airpin. Good move by Reeves.
Reeves then taking the lead. Montreal was the downfall of Sean Hegarty, Callum Lawson, but they're going to stay close. The only way Sean Hegarty can hang on to Tim and Tristan Reeves is stay tucked in the slipstream. It's third place for Roger Lovelock and Aki Alto. Then it's Andy Peach. Then it looks like it is Mark Edwards on the Kawasaki, the first of the Kawasakis. So Suzuki leads, Suzuki second, BMW third, Suzuki fourth. Then it's the Kawasaki of Mark Edwards and Lee Barrett. Hegarty's hanging on to him though, James.
Yeah, he is. It's early doors yet, and with the speed we've seen the Reeves boys yesterday, it's going to be a big ask for that man there, Hegarty, to stay with him, I think, anyway.
And by the way, there's a big builder in ready mixed leathers looking for you after our last commentary.
Yeah, there's something on the grass there.
Here we go. Ben Holland and Lee Watson there.
So he's pulling out.
That's Simon Gilbert, number 11, Simon Gilbert. Oh, and Jed Pilmore Brady there. They are out of it. Simon Gilbert, if he got any luck at all, it would be bad luck. He's finished his first race this season yesterday, and now he's out of it again on Sunday. So the first four getting away. Mark Edwards there, and Barry James, number 112, on the John Cable racing outfit with Mark Howard, serving soldier alongside him. He's going well. So number 11, Simon Gilbert. Jed Pilmore Brady in the chair, and they are parked on the grass. They're out of it, using the curb.
Go on. Yeah, Hegarty just lifting it over the curb there. And there's so much control with what happens with this sidecar wheel as he drives. You can tighten the turn up a bit, lift the wheel up, almost at will over the curbs on the inside.
Well, let's take them then into Riches. They're fifth gear round here. Just short shifting to sixth along that little short straight to Montreal. They're at Montreal now. Back to fourth, possibly third round here, depending on the gearing you've got. Third round Montreal goes Roger Lovelock with Andy Peach looking on the inside and getting the hook into gear. He's got it going. Andy Peach almost alongside, but Lovelock, oh, side by side. How close do you want it? Swapping paint?
Yeah, right across the front end. That was a good move, that.
Andy Peach then, Charlie Richardson in fourth place behind the reigning champions. Mark Edwards, we are on lap two of 10. So a long way to go here, boys. Calm down. Ben Holland, Lee Watson, well, they came from the back of the grid, so they've got an awful lot of work to do.
And Haggerty is hanging with the Reeves boys, you know, here.
He certainly is. The Suzuki of Sean Haggerty is quick. But that bike of Tim and Tristan Reeves, and they're packing up to go to the Southern 100 as well, but they decided they wanted to do this British Championship round. They've committed to doing every one of the rounds they can hang into, but you're quite right. Haggerty is staying with Tim Reeves. He's close enough. He's in the slipstream.
He is.
He's
right,
getting sucked along.
Absolutely. There's nothing in that.
This could also be a test of tyres. Everyone on Avon tyres, of course. That's the control tyre for this series. These big, fat slicks. Car racing tyres in actual fact, cross-ply as well, which is unlike the modern solo racing. And Haggerty showed his nose to Tim Reeves at that moment.
Yeah, around some of these corners, particularly the right-handers, which this Snetton circuit is predominantly a right-handed circuit, these sidecar outfits, with having more grip, three wheels and really big wide wheels and all flat rubber on the circuit, actually go quicker around some of the right-handers than the solos do.
Now look at this, Peach alongside the BMW. This is an outright sprint up the hill, 150 miles an hour as they flash past the end of the pit wall over the start-finish line, throwing it into Riches, back to fifth here. The back end just moving about, Charlie Richardson on the back of Andy Peach's bike, an accomplished Isle of Man TT.
He's trying, that's not going to work.
Showing the nose, there was no room there. He had a look up the inside. But I think Roger Lovelock will be able to hear that screaming Suzuki behind him.
Yep, I think he will. I think he'd have seen him there as well. Just poked his nose up the inside of Peach. But there just wasn't going to be room. Lovelock just closed the door at Montreal Airpin. Fair enough.
Andy Peach, number four, having a good season as well. He's having something of a renaissance in the 2013 Eastern Airways British F1 Sidecar Championship. He's going well. There, Ben Holland and Lee Watson having displaced... they're right there, they're in seventh. Edwards leading James, then it's Holland still in seventh. Then a great ride by Tony Brown and Ryan Anderson in eighth place at the moment. But this battle now for second, third, fourth, fifth, you can see it, is closing up. You're looking at the seventh place crew, but not now. You're with the race leaders.
There's leaders, yep. That's Reeves and Haggerty. This is the battle between... And has Andy Peach got through? He has. Andy Peach is through.
Andy Peach sweeps through into third place. Did it on the brakes at the end. Into the bomb hole he goes.
Yep, and he's been looking at trying that for a couple of laps now.
Exiting the bomb hole onto the corum with the corner which goes on and on and on. This is so, so hard for a sidecar passenger because he's been threatened to spit off the left-hand side of the outfit at every opportunity. And then, of course, he's got to get his weight transferred as they come down to the chicane.
Yeah, and do you know what? Around corums on these things, there's so much centrifugal force pushing, well, both the riders fairly fixed in the thing, but particularly the passenger. And like you say, if you just lose grip, you'd be thrown straight out of the thing at about 130 miles an hour.
Out of the left-hander at Murray's, Barry James has gone past Mark Edwards. So Barry James and Mark Howard, number 112 on the John Cable Racing Suzuki, have gone past the Kawasaki of Mark Edwards. And right behind Mark Edwards, the green bike, you can see the fitting cat Suzuki of Ben Holland and Lee Watson. Fourth place in the championship, these guys, just 4 points adrift, so they need to get the pressure on. Look at this battle at the front, James. Yep. Haggerty has not given up at all.
He's definitely not given up. I didn't think he had this in him, to be honest.
Well, first race winner, Sean Haggerty and Callum Lawson, but in fairness, Tim Reeves coming from the back of the grip.
Yep.
Look at those, both in the 55s. Look at those lap times.
Yeah, 1 minute 55. You're looking at about 5 to 6 seconds slower than a decent superbike time. When you consider these things are pulling probably 400 kilos with the bike and the rider and the fuel on an engine that's probably producing about 200 brake horsepower, just a tad less.
155.845 Tim and Tristan Reeves have done. That is just 2/100ths off the lap record which they set yesterday. So the conditions very much suiting them, suiting their SMT Racing Suzuki, and of course it's suiting Sean Hegarty. Now does Hegarty, and more to the point, do the passengers have the stamina to keep going at this pace? Because it must be grueling.
Yeah, but you know what? At least the passenger has got a little bit of airflow going through the vents in the leathers, and the driver hasn't got it. It's basically just the driver's helmet that's sticking up. Not got a lot of airflow at all over his body.
Mark Edwards there, Lee Barrett on the Kawasaki. They have been relegated slightly. They were in fifth place in the championship. And, of course, their big rivals, Ben Holland and Lee Watson, just 4 points ahead of them, have gone past them. They're race leaders, though. Tim and Tristan Reeves go through the picture, number 77, operating out of a superbike pit lane garage here at Snetterden. And that's a long time since we saw an F1 sidecar outfit based in the garages in pit lane, James.
Yeah, garages are in a bit short supply at most British circuits, but here at Snetterden, they're in really short supply. So to get one, yeah, you've done well, actually. Most teams... The vast majority of teams here in every class work from awnings and from tents.
And what I thought was very encouraging was during the pit lane walk this morning, Tim Reeves was signing autographs like you wouldn't believe. He ran out of postcards and posters, so that says it all, doesn't it?
Yeah, and do you know what? I was chatting with somebody just out in the bleachers there on a banking when I was James Hayden had his races to commentate on. And I was chatting with an old boy who's been coming up here for the last 40 years, did a bit of racing on a gold star. He says he particularly comes for the sidecars. He loves the sidecars. And a lot of the older end actually do. It's a particular favourite is a sidecar race for them.
Well, very colourful, very spectacular. They can see the passenger working, the antics of the passenger. And it is a science. People call them lunatics. I can tell you, it's a real science. It's a skill that not too many people have. And to carry it through to race distance, these are 1 and 2 in the race at half distance. Tim and Tristan Reeves, number 77, reigning world champions, second in race one, unbeaten this year in the races they've contested until yesterday. And they fried a clutch, as indeed did Ben Holland, as indeed did one or two others. So I think the combination of the conditions, the grip on the circuit and the temperature is not kind on clutches.
No, it's not. These engines were meant to, they're 1 litre engines, mostly Suzuki, I've got to say, but they're not any manufacturer. There's Kawasaki out there, BMWs.
And Hegarty! Oh, sorry, James.
Yep.
Hegarty.
He's in.
Oh, yep. And Callum Lawson, a shake of the head, a retirement for Sean Hegarty. That is a mechanical problem, and that is a huge, huge shame.
Sorry. Yeah, and typically these engines work a lot harder in the sidecar outfits than they ever would in the 1 litre solo sports bikes that they came out of. There's other things. It's not just a case of bolting a big 1 litre sports bike engine into a sidecar outfit chassis. There's stuff like on a solo, you don't need to worry about where the oil's going really, because the bike is always in balance. It's like a 1G move the whole time. Whereas on a sidecar, the thing goes sideways and the oil can slosh to one side and not get picked up by the oil pickup and not get spread around the engine. So there's lots of baffles have to go in there. There's lots and lots of work to do to sidecarize these 1 litre sports bike engines.
And to get them not just to go fast, but to go the distance.
That's exactly. They're working a lot harder. They're towing a lot of weight. The clutches have more strain on them, you know.
Ben Holland and Lee Watson up another place, relegating Barry James and Mark Howard, number 112. There they are. So Ben Holland now up to fourth. In fact, yes, he's up to fourth. The retirement of Sean Hegarty and Callum Lawson, unfortunate as it is for them, of course, has done everyone a favour. They all jump up one place, and it will also close up the championship behind Tim Reeves. Tim Reeves is away with it. He's going to march on to something like a 45-point lead. I can see a big dust.
And normally, if there's dust, there's somebody on that dust.
That could be a sidecar wheel. Everybody seems to be on track. We'll soon know. We'll have a look as they come down out of the sunlight. The sun now very low here at Snetterden, of course, but the temperature still very, very high. Ben Holland and Lee Watson, there they go, Finningcat Suzuki.
The track temperature has been up as far as about 48 degrees today, Barry. That's hot.
Well, I'll tell you what, Ben Holland's had a problem, because ahead of him is Mark Edwards. So the dust we saw, in my opinion, and it's pure a guess at the moment, is that Ben Holland has been off the circuit. There is our second place man, Andy Peach and Charlie Richardson. Second, of course, with the relegation, 156.3 done by Reeves, 156.7, so 0.4 of a second slower, Andy Peach. In second place, though, looking good. Second step of the podium beckons for him. We're on lap 7.
And when you can hear these engines coming out of the corners, these bikes coming out of the corners, and it sounds like the clutch is slipping, but it's actually a rear wheel spinning. And you can see the passenger getting right over the back of that driving wheel, right behind his driver, to try and get as much weight on that wheel as possible, try and get the thing driving.
Well, I could hear in my headphones an awful lot of revving, which sounded like a slipping clutch, but I'm sure you're right. I'm sure our on-circuit microphone out there is picking up wheel spin from these great fat slicks. 0.77 of a second now, Peach trails Richardson. Third place, it's Lovelock and Alto. So Tim Reeves out there, 7 seconds. Then it's Barry James, Mark Evans. Holland now down in sixth. So Ben Holland and Lee Watson have had an excursion, that's all I can say.
That might have been the dust we saw.
Could well be. We should be seeing the Finning Cat Suzuki come into shot. Yes, we are. Here they come. So they've had an incident, that's for sure, but they're hanging on to sixth place. If Barry James and Mark Howard, the number 112 outfit, in your shot now, hang on to the fourth place. This is a season best for them, just getting better and better all the time. It is warm. It is very warm out there, and it's warm in the commentary box. You think, as you said, you made the point so rightly, that driver's on his knees in there with a 4-into-1 exhaust system going down, pardon my expression, but between his legs. And, of course, his hand is right down there with 300 degrees coming off the front disc.
Yeah, that's it. Yeah, and there's not really a lot of place for that heat to get out. You know, he's almost closing the top of the fairing. There's no airflow whatsoever. Really get really hot, these boys.
Will be a warm job, but it's a good job almost done for Tim and Tristan Reeves. The brothers reunited, former world champions together in 2004, 2005, if my memory serves me correctly. And retiring,
coming in,
Rupert Archer, Jason Grimes, number 70. Oh, that's a shame for them.
Yeah, that's at the end of the straight there, actually going into the back entrance of the paddock there.
And they had been running in 10th place, so they were on a mission for 6 points, but it's all to no avail. So the Hannafin Suzuki of Rupert Archer out of the running. Not so the SMT Racing Suzuki of Tim Reeves. That's a real study in concentration and passenger agility. Wonderful, wonderful pictures here on F1 Sidecar Racing from Snetterton. I hope you enjoyed your afternoon of motorcycle racing, in particular the stunning British Superbike races here on Eurosport.
A lot of people have enjoyed it from the circuit, but the place is packed. I've had a quick walk around.
It is, and I had the advantage of going up one of these cherry pickers to have a look, and you can't see a bit of grass where the bicycle park is. The motorcycles
packed. Yeah,
absolutely
it is, yeah.
Packed. Wonderful. Tim and Tristan Reeves then.
Around Corrams.
Way in the lead now.
Oh, somebody else is retiring.
Oh, that's Rod Robinson and your Ready Mix colleague, Nick Webb. He's coming to find you, James.
No, he won't find me. He'll be fixing his bike.
We've had a bit of a chuckle over that in the paddock, I can tell you. Wonderful. Nick Webb, Rod Robinson, retiring their Kawasaki. Suzuki, I beg your pardon. So big shame for them. There, Gary Horsepole, number 32. And another of our wild cards there, mixed up with Horsepole. That's good. That's young James Cyril, number 195, with Gary Horsepole, riding an RSR, which is a Rudy Schmidt Racing. So we've got two manufacturers for sidecar chassis in there as well. There it is. That's the Rudy Schmidt Racing RSR. James Cyril, another of those lads up from Bempsey. He's going to be doing a full season next year, sponsored by Rudy Schmidt, a new chassis maker. So that's a refreshing change.
Where's that from? Which country?
Germany.
Okay.
So Rudy Schmidt, it's very like an LCR. It'd have to be, wouldn't it? That's the winning formula.
Yep, it is, yep.
But the RSR, the Rudy Schmidt Racing, there are two of them in this. He's going to run a two-bike team next season in the Eastern Airways Championship. So that's
brilliant.
Good.
Yep.
On the penultimate lap then, 8 laps completed, 2.5 to go of the Snetterton 300 circuit. Andy Peach and Charlie Richardson in second place. holding that interval as well. 7 seconds. Tim Reeves, though, will have been getting the pit board. You know what it's like, James, when you're 7 seconds in front on a day like this, you've just got to bring it home.
Yeah, you knock it off a little bit, you try and save the bike, you don't want to give it any extra stick, you're not thinking about lap records, you're just thinking about bringing it home, like you say.
Charlie Richardson looking good, and looking even better. Tim Reeves coming round. Next time he will collect the last lap flag as he comes down towards Murray's. Now accelerating up the centre straight.
Yeah, it takes a long look behind him, does Tim Reeves. There's nobody there. He's got about 8 seconds lead now.
There he goes, waiting for Andy Peach and Charlie Richardson to hove into view out of Murray's. 5.6, so he's pulled back a little bit.
He has, yep. You get the impression it's this guy, Tim Reeves, just controlling it from the front. Final lap, he ain't going to drop 5 seconds without a major mistake, which he's not used to making mistakes, isn't Tim?
Well, James, I said at the outset that Tim Reeves is probably having the best season ever. He's won world championships before, yep. But he's flawless.
Won his first TT in the Isle of Man, you know, he is having a good season.
And he deserves it. He's put a lot of effort in. He's the height of professionalism, you can see by the appearance. Robin Croft, of course, of SMT, will be thrilled to bits.
Yep, Standish Metal Treatment. That's what SMT stands for. Robin Croft, what a good bloke. Sponsors one or two classes, loves his racing.
And doing well in solo class Superstocks.
Yep, that's right, yeah. Yes. Behind Adam Jenkinson, who leads the British Superstock 1000 Championship.
Fantastic. On the final lap then, Tim and Tristan Reeves. Let's do them a bit of credit here because they've had a wonderful performance. Sean Hegarty and Callum Lawson put up a spirited battle for the majority of the race, but some mechanical problem overcame them. I'd be partially surprised if it were not clutch, because one or two of these big Suzukis have been in trouble with the clutches this weekend. Due in the main, I think, to the heat, the track being so grippy, and I think a lot of the riders trying to feather the clutch a little bit to get
out of
the
small corner. Yeah, like out the end of the straight there, out of well, there's a couple of corners actually, the hairpin as well, Montreal, where you would use the clutch, and out of Murray's, the corner they're coming up to now, they grab a load of clutch just to get the thing driving, and that obviously every time you do that, that wears the clutch and heats it up as well.
Look over the shoulder then, Tim and Tristan Reeves, here they come. Absolutely fantastic. 10 laps completed. They'll be thrilled with that. They take the win. There it is, a little wave, the hand comes out of the cockpit. Andy Peach and Charlie Richardson, second place on the podium. And third place for reigning champion Lovelock with Aki Alto from Finland in the sidecar. They've done a good job. And look at this, Barry James and Mark Howard, best result of the year in fourth. And they were not that far adrift, I can tell you. Just 17 seconds off the winning time. Mark Edwards and Lee Barrett collect fifth place over the line. And it's a battling six. They obviously had some problems, Ben Holland and Lee Watson, but they do preserve their championship standing only just because Mark Edwards, who beat them in this race, just about closes in the championship. But there it is confirmed, Tim and Tristan Reeves. It's another win for these boys. They just march on and on and on. A big thank you to my expert co-commentator. Not usually accustomed to sidecars, but I think he loves it, James.
Yeah, I like the sidecars. Cheers, buddy.
Brilliant. Look at the crowd. That's another thing, of course, James, that the crowd have stayed here, haven't they? It's such a lovely day. Who wants to go home?
Yeah, I've got to be fair. You know, sitting on a grass banking, watching a bit of bikes, whether it be sidecar or solos, there's worse places to be at this point.
Certainly, especially if you've got a can of something open.
Yeah, and a tuber factor 50 in most cases. There's some pink torsos going home today, I'll tell you.
Wonderful. Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. That's it then. The crowd liked that. They enjoyed that. So round of applause from appreciative supporters here in the sun at Snetterton. And I'm sure that gave our track circuit commentator Fred Clark something to eulogise about. Barry James, Mark Howard, number 112, shaking hands with Mark Edwards and Lee Barrett because they had a battle throughout the race. And those two are separated by just about 2 points in the championship now, so it had a lot of meaning, that battle. Well, just closing stages then here, all wrapped up. It's the end of the day. Craig Chaplow and John Briggs, and Chapleau's regular passenger, Kees Endervelt, the Dutchman, has gone away for some of this modern technology forearm surgery to relieve trapped tendons. What's that all about?
Yeah, you get arm pump and you can have an operation. It's quite a complex operation, actually.
Well, that's where Kees Endervelt is, but John Briggs did an admirable job jumping in, and big congratulations to our wildcard riders. Tony Brown, seventh with Ryan Anderson, but victory, Tim Reeves by 4 seconds from Andy Peach. Roger Lovelock completes the podium. Then Barry James, he'll be absolutely delighted. Mark Edwards, the Holland-Watson pairing, Tony Brown and Ryan Anderson. Fantastic. They're actually on a Yamaha, an 04R1, would you believe? Chapleau and Briggs, Drown and Ken Edwards, and Horsepole and Napton brought it home in 10th after a troubled day yesterday. 11th for James Cyril and Steve Wareham. Wonderful. Dan Knight. Oh, Sam Fishwick there. Wonderful. 12. These are wild cards. They ride, if you like, in Division 1 and not the Premier League. So I guess Tim Reeves is going to be up there something like 45 points clear. And what a guess that was. He is indeed 45 points clear of Sean Hegarty, Callum Lawson, Peach and Richardson right there in third. Holland, 3 points clear of Edwards. Oh, dear me. Barry James has done well, 94. So terrific stuff. Holland then under some threat now for his fourth place. He needs to do well at the next round, of course, which is Brands Hatch. Lower down the order, Ricky Stevens, well, his mechanical woes go on and on and on. Roger Boddy's circuit and promoter of this series, 36 points. Ian Guy, 34. John Clark wasn't here today. This 10-lapper promised to be a fierce one as well, and from the start, from pole position, Sean Hegarty and Callum Lawson, number 33, made their intentions clear, getting the drop on Tim and Tristan Reeves from the word go at Riches. It was not long, though, before Tim and Tristan Reeves got their act together. There was dust flying all around as everybody fought for the spare tarmac. An early retirement meant that Simon Gilbert, number 11, was out of it. A battle raged for third place between Andy Peach and Roger Lovelock because the pair at the front were charging away. But never for a moment did Sean Hegarty and Callum Lawson let Tim Reeves get out of sight. Peach and Lovelock scrapped and scrapped, but finally, almost at half race distance, Andy Peach and Charlie Richardson squeezed past the BMW to get their Suzuki up into third place. Then there was a certain amount of drama. A hand went in the air from Sean Hegarty, the driver of the number 33 outfit, and he and Callum Lawson were forced to retire with a mechanical problem into pit lane, gifting Andy Peach and Charlie Richardson second place. That left race leaders Tim and Tristan Reeves 7 seconds clear, and they were able to enjoy the luxury of cruising home, backing off in the closing stages to take the chequered flag with Andy Peach there in second and a brilliant third place for reigning champion Roger Lovelock.
Yes, we are here with Tim and Tristan Reeves. It was a peerless performance out there. Once again, you're on top of the podium. Yesterday, you bagged a second, but you were 22nd on the grid when you started. But it does show that there is some humanity to you and you can be beaten to the top of the podium, Tim. But once again, hearty congratulations, a great performance. Sum it up for us.
Yeah, it was good, wasn't it, really? I didn't get such a good start, but I had a good run around the first corner, managed to nip myself around the outside of Sean, and then he kept me sharp, didn't he? Unfortunately, his gear lever snapped, so put him out. But, yeah, it was good. You know, I always have a good race with him, and it's a bit warmer, obviously, today than normally, but obviously the exhaust pipe's right underneath my legs and through between my groin, so it gets a bit warm. But, yeah, it was good, really. Everything ran good, and just a shame Sean went out.
You're properly cooked at the end of that race, aren't you? What's Netherton like from a driver's point of view?
Yeah, I like it a lot. The only bit that I wish they'd left Russell's it used to be. It was a real good, you know, you could build your speed through Corums and then now you have to sort of back it off halfway through. But it's good. I enjoy it, and Jonathan Palmer's done a great job with the place. It's, you know, it's like a new track, isn't it? It's really good fun, and I enjoy coming here.
We're all reinvigorated by the new Snetterton. Tris, what was it like to be out there in this heat? We've talked about it all day, but 30 degrees is the air temperature and the track temperature's up in the 50s. You've got one of the most physical jobs in racing. What was it like from your point of view?
Yeah, it's definitely hard. You have to make sure you obviously take loads of fluids on before, because with a couple of laps in, your mouth's dry and you got all the heat coming from the radiator. So when you're down out the wind, you're getting heat from the radiator. So you're banging your head against the wall, really. But yeah, it was a good race, enjoyed it. I'd just like to say happy fifth birthday from a little mate of mine called Jake, so cheers.
Nice, nicely done. Right, we'll let you guys go off to the podium, but once again, hi, congratulations.
Yeah, massive thanks to everyone who helps us, all the boys, SMT, my dad, H&S Contractors, DFDS, Haith Boys, Padgett Brakes, everyone who helps us. We're, you know, we just couldn't be here without them. Thanks for having
us. Excellent, nicely done. So we'll let the guys go off to the podium now. Thank you, Tim. So they'll make their way to the podium. Whilst we've got a couple of minutes in hand, we're going to take a short break. But do join us afterwards here at Snetterton, where James Hayden and James Whittam will be wrapping up a very eventful day here at the Norfolk Track. See you back here in a couple of minutes. Well, welcome back to Snetterton. Don't forget, the round 8 of the MotoGP Championship from the Saxon Ring is on its way next weekend, Friday at 12.05. We start our coverage of free practice. That's live, of course, as is the qualifying Saturday at 11.30 in the morning for that. And the races get underway next Sunday morning, 9:15. We will see you for all the race action. And it's all on British Eurosport 2 HD. Wonder if Rossi can do it again. What do you reckon? Hopefully Cal can definitely do it again. James Hayden and James Whittam have joined me here at the end of Pit Lane to help wrap up what has been a very eventful day here at Snetterton. Guys, you're looking good in the sunglasses, but kind of got to with the sun as bright as it has been, haven't we? Let's talk about British Supersport to start off with. And I'll come to you first, Whit, about this, because we heard James on the commentary there. Let's start off about Stuart Easton, because he's had a shocker out there, hasn't he? What was he, 13th place and a 10th place? And from his point of view, a rider like Stuart Easton,
yep.
Absolute disaster.
Complete disaster. Completely disastrous meeting. He had been the winningest rider, I think, in the championship so far. But, yeah, just not what his championship, what he didn't need for his championship. And I think what he's got is just off colour and bike not working how he wants it. And, I mean, if you're going to come and race when you're not feeling so well, you really don't need 30-odd degrees and 50-degree track temperatures, yeah.
No, James, we heard you talking about it during commentary. You're intimate with these riders in this championship.
Who were, madam?
On a weekly basis. How did you read the situation?
Obviously, he is suffering. It's very unlike him. But, you know, you really almost do want to be on top of their floor if you're kind of having a, you know, sorry, I didn't realise that. But, no, I mean, whatever, he's going to be disappointed because, you know, even when you're ill, you've still got to try and slog it out and get up there. And, there's obviously a bit more to that. That's my take.
Yeah, mine too, actually, yeah.
OK, we'll leave it there until we find out exactly what there is. But, yes, I see what you're saying. We've seen Stuart when he's not well before, and he's pulled out better than this.
And riders, when you're not well, you still just slog it out.
You dig in, don't you?
Dig in and you just knock it out. So
we've seen him dig in with broken bones and bits missing. So, you know, a bit of a tickly cough shouldn't be holding him up as much as this.
No. Yeah, absolutely fascinating, that story. And it will run and run, I'm sure. A rider then who's had a fantastic weekend, if we're talking about contrasts, James, is Alistair Seeley.
I'll tell you what, he was just magnificent. He just... And what I really liked about it is he didn't have, it wasn't like he had half a second on anyone, but just a tenth here, a tenth there. And he was so consistent. He was, he just did his thing, got out in front, and then he really worked hard, picked every moment. And it was just a really classy display.
Just didn't make one single mistake. Perfect. Like James said, just nicked bits and bobs just about everywhere without putting seconds here, there. Yeah, fantastic. He does like this place, though.
He does.
I don't think it's
bored.
I don't think it tells us anything about where the championship's going. I think it tells us that he still likes this place really well.
I'll tell you what, the pair of you, I bet you're looking forward to Brands Hatch next round, because we've got Alistair Seeley in the form he's in. We've also got Ben Wilson in the form he's in, because, OK, he had the misfire in the first race, but he was pretty close.
Yep. Ben ain't doing so well. I think I think Ben's riding as back to something like the form we know he's capable of.
Yeah, I mean, I think Ben was. You can't give Alistair Seeley the start. You can't give any of these guys the start. And you know, he matched him for a number of laps in that second one, but he just couldn't pull it back in. And then Alistair Seeley just applied a bit more pressure. So if they can get away together, and I think that Ben is also. We've seen him at Brands.
Yeah, that's why I think Alistair, Ben was never going to stop Alistair yet, really. All things being equal, I think at Brands he possibly can have a go doing it.
Yeah.
And he's done it before. They've both done it before. I mean, if we look at the championship standings now after the Snetterton round, coming into this round, they were only separated by 1 point. No matter what really happens today, you know, there's now a 10-point difference because 25-20, 25-20. So a 10-point difference. 11-point difference now because there's 1 point between them coming in. So it's just one of those things, really, between the pair of them, isn't it? We're going to Brands Hatch and they both fancy their chances there.
Yeah, I don't think Ben will go away from Snetterton knowing that his teammate Alistair Seeley has a form he normally has here, being that disappointed. I think 2 seconds, damage limitation, it was always going to be that for him, and I think he'll go away from here upbeat.
Yeah, no, I agree. You know, he was quick. He was unlucky in that first one with the misfire. And, you know, he's proving that, well, they're proving as a team. I mean, they must be over the moon, the Keelan Kawasaki
two.
Two riders up there fighting for the championship, you know, for 1-2. I mean, they're doing a brilliant job. And the bikes look good.
And they are doing a brilliant job, aren't they? Because it's clean. Yeah. It's clean. It's tough, but it's clean. I don't know. I wasn't expecting them to be dirty, but I thought we'd get a bit of personal niggle going on.
So far, but we can always hope for that.
Excellent. Let's talk now about the superbikes then. And I'll come to you, James, first on this. Let's talk about Alex Lowes. Because in race one, I would argue his performance, I think, was superb. He's getting better and better against the rivals he needs to get better against, isn't he?
Yeah, very much. I mean, also in that first race as well, until the penultimate lap, he didn't ever have more than 0.8 of a second. So he couldn't actually put a foot wrong, you know, and to absorb that pressure lap after lap, not make mistakes, showed there's some real maturity there. You know, we saw his speed, and just at the end, he said, a couple laps to go, he just lifted it up a notch and he managed to break the pack. But it was a really good, solid ride in the first one. And actually, you know, it was, well, I guess we'll come to the second one in a second, but, you know, he's...
It wasn't about riding the second one, was it?
No, it was a great ride. But I tell you what I hadn't noticed until that. I do think Shaky's bike looked... It looked a lot quicker coming out of here.
When you looked at that, you know, we were trying to suss that out. It did look to have a little bit of a jump on the Samsung Honda of Alex Lowes up this, particularly start and finish straight. But when you looked, Shaky was really good at dropping it in a little bit slow mid-corner and turning
standing
it back. He got it stood right off the edge of the tyre and opened the throttle a lot harder than Alex. Different ways of doing it, and I think that made his bike look a little bit quicker. I don't think there was that much difference.
Yeah, well, Alex likes to take those sweeping runs, especially when he's catching people, doesn't he? And that's
I mean, personally, I thought the penultimate lap, he got a brilliant drive out of there. I thought that Kawasaki had the edge on it, which
he needs more speed now. People have caught up. But I saw what you saw.
Yeah, and I just thought it was interesting. You're only ever going to notice it here because of those strengths, the way you're coming on, and how long they are.
Exactly.
On most of the times, you'd never even see it. But here, for me, I just thought it looked quite obvious. It just had a little bit, and it meant that it was very difficult for him ever to be in a position to pass because he was all the time just nipping back on the back wheel, if you know what I mean.
Yeah, if you've got a bike that's just a little bit quick, you can put yourself in that position so you can get past on the brakes. If you've got a bike that's a little bit slower, you never put yourself there.
No, well, Shane Byrne in race two did have the machinery under him, as you just said, and, well, really, from there, there was very much a point to prove, I've got the machinery, now watch me go. Is that how you saw a bit of that?
Yeah, I think we saw how disappointed Shaky Byrne was after race one, and if he'd have gone away from here without a win completely at all, he would have been really disappointed. I'm telling him how much swearing he would have done, or would have been doing now if he hadn't had that second race win. But yeah, fair play to him.
Yeah, and I think the other, you know, obviously, as James said, he was so disappointed after that first one. They've come back, they've re-looked, they've changed a different front tyre. You know, they've made quite a few modifications and, you know, made all the difference. But it's also, again, it's quite scary for there's a great burnout from Shaky there. But, I mean, yeah, we had 10 races so far and he's won 7 of them. And, you know, that is really some form that he's in. And, yeah, I think Josh was a bit unlucky, obviously. Mm-hmm. We saw him. He was just trying. He looked hungry. He looked he might well grab that win, and obviously just a fraction too much. But just avoid him. Had to run wide, and that sort of cost him. But I think they're going to want to start. They're going to want to start beating Shaky. Do you know what I mean?
They've got to do it before the showdown starts.
Let's take a look at the standings at the moment, and focus in on the showdown. Because do you think that Josh Brooks is starting to feel perhaps a little frustration, because he knows that when it comes to the showdown, he has to
beat Shaky at this point. Even frustrated. He's probably frustrated with himself, but Josh Brooks is definitely kind of, his head's down a little bit more than I've ever seen him with it.
Well, also, I mean, whatever we say right now, Shaky is dominating, right? You know, he is dominating. At the end of the day, you've got almost something to break their rhythm, break their, you know, it's like, you know, if you're going to try and race him, you don't want him to keep, you know, winning and getting this mind frame where he expects to dominate every session, expects to win every session. And you know, he's going to be, we knew Shaky, look, you know, he's the most successful British Superbike rider ever. So we knew he was going to be hard to beat.
No, you're right. The podium credits are up on screen now, but we don't have a monitor in pit lane. Our monitor's gone down, so we can't see it. So it's 23 points to Shane Byrne. Alex Lowes is on 16, Brooks is on 13, Ellison is on 6, and Keogh is on 2. So the podium credits do come in obviously very important when we get to the showdown. Yeah. And already, Shaky is starting to inch
rack him up.
And you're right, though. I mean, right now, when it's a difference of 1 point, it makes a fractional difference. But it's more to do with what it's doing up there.
Exactly.
Yeah. And that's the point.
And we've seen the way the showdown system works. We've seen the dominant rider throughout the whole of the first part of the season, the main season, not win the championship. We've seen that twice.
Yes.
So anything can happen once we get in there.
Yep, can't wait until we get to that. James.
Yeah, whatever.
The two Jameses.
I've answered to worse than that, mate.
Yeah, I know you have, last night. but guys, thanks very much for everything you've done. Appreciate all the work today. Thank you for watching. Before you go, they get the diary out because we've got a couple of things coming up to tell you about. And if you've missed anything from today at Snetterton, if you've been otherwise engaged in sporting nature, you know what we're talking about, then you can see the highlights tonight at 10:30. They are this evening on British Eurosport 2 HD. And our Superbike Sunday, we've got one coming up on Sunday the 21st of July. It's a very early start indeed, 8:30 in the morning. We kick things off live on British Eurosport 2 HD for World Superbikes from Moscow Raceway. That's round 8 of the championship. And MCE British Superbikes, round 6 from Brands Hatch. I'll say it again just so it sinks in. 8:30 in the morning, we are live and we will be on with you all day. But that is it from Snetterton, from the team here. We've had a great day's racing. We've been sun-kissed. We've had some superb Superbike action. I hope you've enjoyed it too. We'll see you next time. Until then, thanks for watching. Bye for now. Just live.